Thanks, everybody. Welcome to Build. I'm your host, Ricky Camilleri. Our next guests are the hilarious comedians and actresses and directors behind the new Netflix film, The Breaker Upperers. Madeleine Sami and Jackie Van Beek play two women who form a company that helps people break up with their partners. Let's take a look.
Sheree don't want to be with you no more. Sheree don't want to be with you no more. Sheree don't want to be with you no more. I'm sorry, Jeff, it's over.
What?
Hello, Breaker Uppers. You want to be single by March? Consider it done.
Just because we got gay marriage doesn't mean we need to follow through, you know? I didn't vote for it.
You weren't gay 8 months ago, Russell.
I want a nice, clean break. I don't want years of heartache and stalking and therapy and possible violence.
I'll shoot your faces.
You work for weak assholes who don't have the guts to talk to their partners.
Yep. I'm Jen and this is Mel.
Hey, Mel.
Hi. Jordan, how can we help?
I want to break up with the moments.
Shut him down! Put him on the ground!
Mel. Mel.
Hot.
What?
What?
Don't forget our number one rule. Don't get attached.
Oh, screwing a minor. Go you.
He's not a kid, he's just a younger man.
Oh, sick. A lot younger.
Disgusting.
He's 18.
Oh, legal.
Oh, hell no! This better be Kane's at camera.
There hasn't been a show since the 90s. I don't even know how you know that.
Do not talk to me, white girl.
Okay, I'm not white.
This is the sort of thing that happens when you take charge, Mel.
Are you guys strippers?
Yes.
Maybe I should go gay.
Do you find Kristen Stewart hot?
Who's Kristen Stewart?
No, you're not gay.
Smash it! Everybody, please welcome Madeleine Sami and Jackie Van Beek. Hey, thanks so much for being here. Congratulations on this incredibly funny, awesome movie that the two of you directed and wrote and starred in and produced and did the sets for and shot the movie. I'm not sure.
We did the craft service, catering. We did our own sewing.
We did sewing. Yeah, we did sewing. I was your stand-in, so
you
I stood in for you.
Yeah, and then
time.
I stood in for you.
You also stood in for me. No, it's all a lie. We co-wrote, we co-directed, and we co-starred. Yeah,
that
we
was
did
enough.
Nothing else.
What was it like directing together?
Mad.
I want to see what you're going to say.
Yeah.
It was really fun. Yeah, it was crazy. It was when we decided to do all of the three roles, we really kind of surrendered to the fact it was going to be a bit of a circus, and it was. Yeah, but in a fun way, a fun circus.
Fun circus? Yeah. You knew how to disagree well with each other and how to agree well with each other?
We had a very short shooting time, and so we were aware that any, like, especially on the directing side of things, any, if we discussed things or disagreed too much, it was going to cut into our acting time.
Right.
So, and as we're both vain people.
Our egos demanded.
Our egos demanded the most time for the acting, so we just were like, okay, well, if ever we disagreed on something, we were like, let's go fast and shoot it your way and then my way. And then we've got the option.
Yeah, and it didn't actually happen that much because we co-wrote over, like, right. You know, we worked on it for 4 or 5 years. You know, we were so clear on what the story beats were. So there were never huge, you know, disagreements. No, and we'd just kind of, you'd have a go, then I'd have a go if we, you know.
If we disagree.
Where did the initial idea come from?
It was, I'd like how, any time I'm asked that, she does that weird pose like that. I like it though. I love it.
Why do you always leave it to her to answer this question?
Yeah, that's right. It's cruel.
Why not?
I think we should break format and you should answer the question.
Okay. Okay. Do that thing to me. Throw to me. That's good.
I'm intimidating,
actually,
isn't it?
It was Jackie. The thought came to Jackie singularly on her own.
Okay, so Jackie, where did you get
it? Okay, so I was just mucking about in my house, and the idea just popped into my head when I was thinking about, like, all of those conversations I've had in my life about that level of dread that people have when they realise they have to break up with their partner. And I thought, I reckon people would pay a lot of money to not have to do that themselves and to outsource it. And terrible idea for life, but I thought maybe a good idea for a movie. And so
she thought, who's the most good lookingest, attractive,
articulatist,
talentedest, person in New Zealand to make this film, make a film about it with, yeah. And she emailed me.
And Tyke didn't answer, and so then I called Madeleine, and Madeleine answered, which was so cool.
I just thought it was a great concept for a comedy, and then over the years of writing it, we developed the sort of worked out what we wanted it to be about, and essentially it's kind of a buddy romance rom com in a way. Or a womance is what we've coined.
Womance.
Like a bromance, yeah, but with women.
I like that.
She came up with that.
Yeah. I like that more than bromance because bro is just such a horrible word, you know. Just
you think you not call your friends bro?
No. Oh, God, no.
No.
Oh, God,
you call your brother bro? No.
I don't have a brother.
Sorry.
Yeah, I definitely call my woman friends my woes.
No,
I don't.
You don't.
I don't, but I will
You're
start.
You're full of lies today.
I will start.
Every second thing you say is a lie today.
So you were writing this movie for 4 or 5 years? Or three years?
And then no, it was about 4 years.
4 years.
Wow. Had you written together before?
No, but we'd acted together a lot. We both came up through sort of improv and theatre backgrounds. So we'd actually been in a lot of shows together. So we had a friendship from that, and also we knew we loved performing with each other, so it sort of grew out of that. And we were essentially writing the film to be in it, and then the decision to direct it came a bit later.
How did that come about?
We're just like, oh,
well, Tyka's
got Thor, so he's going to be away for a while. No, Tyka's the only one we'd want to direct it. He's a good friend of ours, and we both wanted to kind of step up and do it ourselves. And
because we've been writing for so long, the vision was so strong, you know, for us that it did seem a little bit ridiculous to hand it over at that point. And also Tyka and Jermaine had just done What We Do in the Shadows, where they did all three of those roles. And so we had, you know, the perfect kind of formula, you know, we knew it worked, and we thought, if they can do it, we can do it. Yeah.
Did you ask Tyka for any advice when it came to directing or anything like that? I mean, he's a producer on the movie, right?
Yeah, he's an EP. Well, I mean, like Madeleine said, like, he's a good friend of ours. You know, I've known him for a long time. So we all kind of, but he was really useful. Like, he'd weigh in on, you know, at the script stage and also with casting and when we're getting our heads of department together and in the edit. So it was great. Like, you know, we'd give him a call, or he'd call and write some notes.
I mean, he's a really busy guy, but he definitely tried to help where he could, and chat about like the look and how we should shoot it, and got us, you know, like, we weren't sure about shooting with two cameras, and he kind of was like, you need to, because he knows us really well and he knows we like to rattle on and improv a lot, so two cameras is kind of like necessary to keep things moving fast.
Keep the editor sane as well, you know, so they can actually cut stuff together when we're rabbiting on.
Do you find yourselves improvising a lot in scenes, or did you devise scenes for you to be able to improvise?
Some scenes are more improvised than others. There's one pivotal scene that we had forgotten to do a rewrite on until we arrived in costume on location on the day, and we were like, oh shit, that's right, we never did that rewrite. And so that scene, there's a lot of improv in there.
It's about five, there's like about 2 pages, and it was like, and then Jackie and Madeleine will improv from here.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. But we also deliberately, you know, we wanted to make the script as tight as possible before we went into production, but we wanted to also, we both like to keep it alive. We were kind of rehearsing it and coming up with improvs in pre-production, and we deliberately cast people that we knew were good improvisers as well, because we wanted them to be able to bring what they could bring to the character as well. So, yeah, I mean, we both like to kind of, we would do anything to make the movie funnier. So if we bring great actors on who we know could improv, it'd like be stupid to get in the way of that. So we try and get our script out of the way and save a little time for a bit of improv.
This is the script. This is what we thought was funny last year.
Yeah.
Let's see.
Yeah, and
so
sometimes, you know,
anything.
It's funny. You get into a scene and you do the scene that you thought was so funny. It's always been funny. Every read-through got a laugh. And then you get it, you stand it up, and for some reason it's not as funny anymore. So you have to come up with something else, you know. So.
But I really am curious. You get to the set and you have this scene that you have not written, basically. Or you needed rewrite on.
We'd written versions of it. Yeah, but we brought Jermaine Clement up, you know, in our last week of rehearsal, and we were workshopping the scene with him, and I remember us all agreeing, oh yeah, this needs a rewrite because we're not happy with it, and then we just forgot to do it.
We came up with a couple of lines. We sort of knew where we wanted it to end. Right. We knew what the scene, what the ending of the scene was. We knew the story point, and we just didn't know what we were going to say to get to that point. And then we ended up with a lot of crazy improv.
A lot of options, yeah.
A lot of options. And a lot of corpsing. You know,
that's amazing. Were you nervous or scared when you realized that in the moment that you were getting there to shoot and you hadn't done
I don't think so. No.
I think we were both quite exhilarated. And at that point, we were quite tired. We were like 3 weeks into the shoot. And so we're just like
punch drunk. And you're like, this will be fun. Like,
oh, a little
be
bit.
Fun.
Yeah. And I'm also like, I know what it's like in a scene with her. And I know that we, whatever we do, we'll have fun. So at the very least, even if we don't come up with any good improv, it'll be fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For us.
For us. For no one else.
And the scene will be
everyone else is just like, oh, man. Can we call
cut? The crew is holding the camera.
Yeah.
Because we were in, you know, in front of the camera and we were directing, often our producer, one of our producers, Ainsley, would end up calling cut. We'd hear this like, cut. We need to move on.
Well, I think you've got enough now. I think you've got enough.
Let's cut, please.
Because the two of you just like performing so much together.
We just thought we were delivering gold, you know?
Like to see how far you can take a scene, I would imagine, as well. Just drive it as far as you can.
Yeah, you're just trying to find the funniest, like, just trying to make each other laugh, pretty much. Often we were so tired as well, so we wouldn't even know if we'd been going on an hour or 2 minutes.
It was good to have an hour. It was good to have Ainsley.
One of my favorite parts of the movie is a karaoke video that appears about a quarter of the way maybe into the movie or halfway into the movie. I just watched that and I thought, I just can't imagine how fun it was to make this karaoke video. It's like those old karaoke videos that play behind songs when you go to Chinatown and sing karaoke or... Yeah, they're just like a couple in a field, on a river, somewhere else. Where did the idea come from to shoot this, and what was it like to get the chance to make one of those?
That was really a scene that was in a lot of that was around in really early drafts of the film. We always knew we wanted a way to kind of tell the backstory of our friendship, but in a not so usual way. And the karaoke video was that way to kind of get a bit of backstory in, but make it fun. And so I'm a huge karaoke fan. I love those videos. I always get mesmerized by them on a night out. And it's like, why in this emotional song are we just looking at zoomed in pictures of ducks on a pond?
Have you ever had that experience where you're at a karaoke thing and you're pointing out the video and you're mesmerized and everyone's like, yeah, it's just a video. And you're like, no, this is so weird.
It's so weird.
Kind of like let it go on behind them.
Yeah. So we just wanted to kind of do that and be able to tell the backstory, but then also make it really weird. It was really fun to shoot. We had to get our amazing cinematographer, a woman called Jenny Lone, we had to get her out of her good habits of creating beautiful shots.
Yeah, she kept wanting to like, oh, no, I have to go again because there was a bit of a jump. They were like, oh, no, that's good. If anything, we need to go again to make it worse, like the camera work worse.
Yeah, but it was a lot of fun to shoot. And it was hard to cut as well because there's a lot of times where we just laugh. Like and so we're having to cut out of shots, really.
I imagine laughing so hard in the editing room on that as well, though. I mean, and as you said, like having your cinematographer shoot worse than they would normally shoot, there's these great moments in it where the two of you are not in the center of the frame, like you're coming at each other, but you're oddly framed to different like eye lines. It looks like it was so much fun to make. I mean, it's really fun to make something bad.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I could just do it forever. I mean, hopefully we haven't unintentionally done that, but...
No, not at all.
What do you mean bad? No. We tried to make the best music video possible. No.
And then we got to meet Celine. We actually got to meet Celine after that, which was very exciting for us in Australia. Yeah, so... And she'd seen the video. She hadn't seen the whole movie, but she'd seen her bit. You know,
I thought she just saw the trailer.
Oh, I thought she saw just the...
I'm going to text her.
Text her. I thought she'd seen just the karaoke video, but... No, I don't know. She was a bit vague with us, wasn't she?
Yeah.
Text her.
Okay. I'll text her after.
So yeah, don't text her now.
I can't text her.
How did you go about casting all the people around the two of you? I mean, both of you are hilarious, but some of your supporting cast is really funny as well.
Yeah, a lot of them are really good friends of ours. A lot of them were available on the day we needed them to shoot. Sometimes we'd have to do a bit of a ring around.
It's a bit like that in New Zealand. Like... we've been in a lot of Tykus films. You know, you sort of have this community of like-minded comedians and actors around you and everyone kind of knows everyone a little bit in New Zealand. And
it's so small.
We'll get them to be in our movie and then we'll go be in their movies. There's only about one movie made every year in New Zealand. And so this was the one, so we got all the actors from New Zealand in it. pretty much.
How did you get to be the one?
Don't know. I don't know. We worked long and hard, though.
Good producers. Yeah. It's more than one movie made per year.
It's about two.
Oh, okay, okay. So you're one of two. That's great.
It's like four or five.
And James Rolleston, who's in our film, who's not in this poster, he's in all of them.
Yeah, he's like, pretty much in all
like
New Zealand movies.
Movie
he's the young guy that plays.
We've got one movie star. It's James Rolleston.
Yeah.
And he's in our
He's
movie.
In all the movies.
Yeah.
So we had to cast him.
He's in all the movie.
Is there? Would you say that there is a defining sensibility of the sort of New Zealand sense of humor? It feels very particular to New Zealand, but at the same time, it feels from Taika's films, and not just because he made a mockumentary, and also yours, a very Christopher Guest-like dry humor that has somehow translated very well to New Zealand.
Yeah, other people kind of outsiders to New Zealand certainly seem to define, you know, what New Zealand humor is. And we're kind of becoming more and more aware of it and being able to recognize it. Yeah, but
outsiders trying to go, this is what you are.
That's what happens.
Yeah, people call it New Zealand comedy. We just call it comedy.
Yeah, because we opened at South by Southwest, and that's right. And it went very well. It was strange opening to its first audience was an American audience. And yeah, people afterwards were like, that's New Zealand comedy, like the dryness, and they'd give us these key words, and so you start going, okay, that's the definition of.
It's quite self-deprecating. It's a little awkward sometimes, and that's kind of just what New Zealanders are like, and we kind of
there's warmth, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. I would say there's the awkwardness of British comedy, right, which is painful, which is intentionally driving pain into your laughter.
I love it so much.
As do I. And then with New Zealand, it feels like there's like a little learned from all of these, but a sense of warmth and love and camaraderie that comes through all of the film.
And kind of there's a silliness,
I think. There's a sort of sweet naivety as well, which
From being one of two movies that are made a year.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
no joke. I don't want to knock.
Three or four a year. We'll need to talk to the film commission, won't we? Just to get your stats
We're
right.
Pretty sure
that,
it's
Madeleine.
One or two.
What was the hardest part about making the Breaker Upperers?
Saying the
I think it was just wearing all those hats. I mean, you know, in our pre-production, we didn't have a long time to shoot. We shot it in 28. Days left.
25 days.
25 days. Yeah. Wow. And just being able to kind of focus on the acting and then also focus on the directing. Like, I know for me, some nights I'd go home and go, oh, damn it, we should have got that shot. Or, oh, damn it, I should have done that option in a performance thing. And it's really hard to kind of be focused on both things at the same time and kind of dividing your mind into those two jobs.
And to remember... and also we needed to remember to give ourselves time on screen, because we'd often get all the guest support actors, get all their bits done first, and then we'd turn the camera around and be like, oh shit, we've only got 2 minutes to do us now.
There was a lot of times where there were pivotal scenes with our characters where we'd spend so much time getting brilliant improv out of our supporting characters that then we had no time for ourselves.
We had like 3 minutes. I was like, oh no.
And you got 2 minutes to shoot the pivotal scene.
That's something that Jermaine actually said to us. He said, remember to save time for yourselves. And I think we got better at that as we went along. But
definitely. But that was definitely the hardest, just trying to split your focus and making sure that you're getting everything you want from both of those things.
Both of you have directed independently of each other. You've made a film and you've directed some television as well. Do you think you'll come back and direct something together again?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah. We're reading a lot of scripts at the moment. So thinking, like, we want to make another film together, which I think will be really fun.
As performers and directors.
As performer directors, but we're also reading a lot of other people's scripts and pitching on those films just as directors, you know, getting someone else to do like the 7 years of hard work of the writing, and then we're like, oh, we could direct that. So we're looking potentially at doing that as well, which would be fun.
That's awesome. I think we have some questions from our audience. We have two. Who has a... Hey, right here.
Hi.
Hello.
I
was wondering, it seems like for the past 15 years, people were done with romantic comedies, mm-hmm. and we had to go to the buddy comedy or the, what was it,
romance
towards that, but now we're slowly finding our way back into the more classical, not so cynical. So what did you think those two transitions happened back then when we needed to be more cynical and right now? And in a movie like this, how do you keep it balanced between being cynical but heartfelt and warmth as well?
Yeah, we really enjoyed writing like the premise and fleshing out the premise of this film, and that was really fun, like working out what the jobs were, the breakup jobs, and but then the real work for us was, like you say, finding the heart of the film and really focusing on the relationship to try and have some pathos to the film, you know, that would ground it in something emotional, and that's where the kind of the harder work was for us.
Yeah, and I think also the thing for us was, you know, we've grown up on all those rom-coms, you know, those brilliant 90s, you know, something starring Jennifer Aniston or J-Lo or whatever. You know, and for us, so I love those films, but there's also part of me that's like, that's not what life is like. And so what we wanted to kind of blend those, the idea of like, you know, making something romantic about friendship, you know, or, you know, upending some of those cliches a little bit. That was kind of like our MO when we were writing the film. So...
To have warmth as part of, you know, because it is quite a, you know, it's a fun but slightly cynical premise. So to make sure that there was kind of warmth and generosity, you know,
a bit of romance well. Still.
Yeah.
Even though we're quite a cynical premise. Yeah.
I think we have time for one more question.
Hi, I'm Rafi Fuentes. Thank you for being here.
Hey, no worries.
My question is, what's
thank you for being here.
Oh, yeah. My pleasure.
Thank you for asking us a question.
You're welcome. My question is, what's the best advice to pitch a show or a movie to, say, Netflix or any other streaming service online?
I would say to be, like, really clear on your idea and to have tested that idea on many, many friends and people. And if someone tells you your idea is terrible, then to make sure you go home and, like, change up the idea would be, like, number one for me.
Yeah. I would say that the same thing as what Jackie just said. No,
I think originality also, like, is really important.
Yeah, I think, I mean, like with this film, for example, when we were writing and we'd go around and tell it and people would say, what are you working on? And we'd say, oh, it's this film about these two women that break up couples for cash. It would instantly elicit like a response from them. Oh, I wish I had that in my life. Oh, that sounds hilarious. I can't wait. You know, and we knew that we were on to something that people would be interested in. So that was always a good sign. But also just, you know, really, really do your homework and be quite well prepared, I think, before going into meetings with those people, because they want to be in a meeting with someone who sounds like they know what they're talking about. Yeah,
you know what I think the movie with where the movie's successful is that it goes very quickly beyond that pitch, that idea, like that sentence, that pitch is really great, and you can immediately be like, that sounds fun. But the within the movie, there's actually very few scenes of the two of you breaking people up. It's like once you've established that that's a funny idea, it becomes very much about these two characters and about their lives as friends and their lives with the people around them. And I think that is what makes it a much more successful comedy rather than like a series of sketches of them breaking up random people.
We worked really hard on that, so I'm so glad you noticed.
Well, you can tell. I mean, it's what separates it from lots of other kinds of comedies, you know?
In fact, when we test screened it a lot, you know, and we had one big test screening with like 350 people who filled out surveys and everything, and we actually had to go back into pickups and film the job that you saw in the trailer of the singing telegram, because people, there weren't enough jobs, you know, like we'd really erred on the side of the friendship, and so we filmed one more job to stick in there.
Yeah, it's really about finding that balance, and it's that's that thing of you want a story to follow, you want some people to follow, but then you also want the fun of the premise. Yeah. And so it's just about striking that balance within the writing, and then once we were in the edit, just working out where that went.
Yeah. Yeah. I love the film. Congratulations. It premieres on Netflix this Friday.
Yes.
Is it this Friday?
Yeah.
Congratulations. Everybody give them a huge round of applause.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, guys.